All right, so hello again, everyone. Welcome back. Today we will go on talking about teaching English vocabulary. The previous week, we talked about the vocabulary lists. And what do you remember? If you have to summarize the previous week, what do you remember from the previous week? You can, again, this week, you can use your microphones if you like, or you can chat. Hazan, 500 most common words you remember, corpus you remember, okay?
If you learn or teach the most basic words in English vocabulary, we can improve our speaking more easily.
Good, good. Anything else?
We also talked about the importance of vocabulary and...
Okay, we also talked about the importance of vocabulary, why we believe vocabulary is the most important component in languages. Vocabulary comes first, Mirai. All right, so these are the things that you remember. Good. And I checked your essays here in our Google Classroom, okay? The essays of the first week. And only one person hasn't done it. Esra Nur Yücetepe, but the others, all of you, have done your task, and you will receive your points. All right, so this week we will go on with teaching English vocabulary, talking about teaching English vocabulary. But before we go on this, you know, usually I always say that we need conscious practitioners. We need teachers who are aware of their strengths and weaknesses. Okay, and we said that teachers need to be aware of their students. Teachers need to be aware of the interests and needs of their students, right? So conscious practitioners, conscious teachers are those who are aware of themselves, first of all. What kind of person are you? What are your strong sides as teachers? Okay, and what is your philosophy? Do you have a philosophy? What is your philosophical stance? How do you look at the language education? How do you look at your students? How do you look at the educational system? How do you look at what is your how do you perceive your course books, the materials, the instruments, the environment, and everything else? These are very important things, and these are all related to the philosophy that you employ. And related to these philosophies, we have some theories of learning. Like, what are the theories of learning? For example, if I ask you, you remember this from other classes, from other courses. What are the theories of learning? Do you remember? Okay, what if I say we have behaviorism, and we have cognitivism, and we have constructivism, for example? Do you remember these? Behaviorism, cognitivism, constructivism. If you remember, what do you remember about behaviorism, first of all? We are talking about these theories because we want to know how people learn. We need to know how our students learn. Okay, not only learn a language, but in general, how they learn. Okay, and then we will associate some, we can establish some links with these theories and vocabulary teaching. So is there anything that you can say related to these three theories? Okay, there are some names like Watson, Pavlov. Okay, let's review. Behaviorism is, in behaviorism, learning is a process of reacting to external stimuli. Right? Behavior can be explained without considering mental states or consciousness. Like in animals, some people like to avoid, like to neglect this theory, but actually we can use it with people, with students. Okay? So you as teachers, for example, you instruct your students, you expose them to some kind of certain materials or instructions, and then they react. They react to your instructions or to your materials. There is Your students, of course, your students have brains. Okay, they are mental creatures, and they will always use their brains. But in this kind of learning environment, there is more reaction than conscious, cognitive process in behaviorism. In cognitivism, learning is a process of acquiring and storing information. Now we start to use our schema in the brain, our mental power more, and then changes in behavior are a reflection of what is in people's minds. So these two are different. Okay? And constructivism, learning is a process of constructing subjective reality. So this is something to discuss. Is reality subjective or is it objective? Reality. Okay? Based on previous knowledge and objective reality. So here, you may expose your students, all of your students, to the same material, to the same instructions, to the same environment, and everything can be the same. But each student, maybe, would you agree that every student is a different world? I guess you would, right? So this means that every person will consume the things that you are giving in a different way. They will perceive the world in a different way. All right, so the things that they experience, let's say that you have 20 students in your class, but each student is a different world, okay? Of course, they will have similar, characteristics, but they will perceive the world in different way, so they will have different experiences. After the first lesson, for example, the previous week, I'm sure that each of you had different experiences, different feelings, different thoughts about our lesson, right? So this is all about the constructivism, and behavior is the result of testing personal hypotheses. In constructivism, each of you have your own background, you have your own education. Each of you know different things, maybe. Of course, there are common things that you know. So this is how people learn, by constructing, by putting something from their own, and by associating links with the things that they have learned and the things that they learn. All right, so these three things, they are different. These three theories provide different explanation for learning. So if we associate behaviorism with vocabulary teaching, how would be, in your opinion, vocabulary teaching in behaviorism? What is your opinion? We said that in behaviorism, students usually react, okay? They use their body more than their brain, in other words. So if we try to teach vocabulary, considering or adopting the behaviorism, the theory of behaviorism, how would vocabulary teaching be in this kind of environment or condition? Do you have any idea? Nurdan, I would ask them a word. All right. And then you would ask them to tell you the meaning or what? Well, actually, is this really about behaviorism or cognitivism? Because now when you ask your students, when you give them a word and you ask them to give you the L1 equivalent of this word, you are actually asking your students to construct some kind of cognitive process. They will have to establish the links between L1, their native language, and L2, English, or the language that they are learning. Zeynep, vocabulary can be taught by drama, maybe. By drama. All right. Can you elaborate on this? Anything else? All right. So let's check some of the examples. Behaviorist, in the behaviorist approach, we are concerned with learners responding to some form of stimulus. As I said, you might expose your students to a kind of material or to your instructions. So this is stimulus coming from outside, okay? And behavior can be shaped through reinforcement. Practice promotes desired behavior. This is what happens in behavioristic approach. Behavioristic learning theory. So in this kind of environment, if we know that there is stimulus, if you know that there is reinforcement, okay, if you know that there is practice, and if you want to adopt this approach, what kind of vocabulary activities or exercises should we prepare? And the big question is, what is your personal opinion? At what level would this approach be more appropriate? Do you have an idea? Now, we have some, I've got also some examples here. TPR, Hasan, yes. So what is TPR? What is TPR? Total physical response. Good. So what is it? What is total physical response? I mean, who can give me an example in terms of vocabulary teaching? What kind of total physical response will be in vocabulary teaching environments?
Teacher.
Yes, Berkay.
For example, in the summer, I asked my cousin to guess the meaning of knife. While I'm doing this, I was like, as if I was cutting a bread with a knife on my hand.
Okay.
And so you easily guess the meaning. And
okay, body language. You use your body language and gestures, mimics. You say like cutting knife. So you saw knife is like this. Okay, total physical response. Anything else? Any other example? How can we use total physical response in vocabulary teaching environments? Can we say, for example, maybe we teach our students some basic vocabulary like colors, okay? And then we may ask them to show us something that is specific color. Like you can say, who will show me something that is red? Okay, so now they have to move, right? This is total physical response. You expose them to your instruction, then they have to show you something that is red, maybe in the class. Maybe they will stand up, walk around the class, and then grab something that is red. They will show it to you. Or while sitting, they will show you the red pencil. Then you will say, show me something blue. Okay, they will show you something blue. Okay, like that. So this is total physical response. Sumaira, in classes where we deal with kids, I also use body language. All right, so in this behavioristic approach, we say that repetition, it can be written and oral repetition. So TPR, simple matching, drawing, painting, and coloring will be appropriate vocabulary teaching activities and exercises at this level when we adopt the behavioristic approach. And for what level, I mean, both proficiency level and age level, would this be more appropriate in your opinion, using the behavioristic approach and using these type of activities?
I think it's more proper for kids.
For kids, okay.
Yes.
When we consider the age level, you mean that for young children, maybe preschool children?
Yeah, young learner, yes.
Okay, young learners, preschool children, adopting the behavioristic approach would be more appropriate. And what else? Rabia, young learners, okay. Alperen, if we show them some animations or pictures, would it be a behavioristic approach? Well, yes, you can, Alperen, you can show them two pictures, okay? So you teach the colors, or let's say that now you teach animals, all right? And you have two pictures, and you say, show me the tiger. Now you have one tiger, one lion. Okay, show me the tiger. So they will have to show the tiger. That's it. Okay, simple. This is simple matching, like this. Simple matching activity. You show them some visuals, some pictures, and you ask your students to show you the correct thing. Right? You ask them, show me the red color, show me the red one, show me the blue one, show me the cat, show me the elephant, etc. Like this. Yes. So, with young children, young learners, preschool children, we could say that it is more appropriate to use the behavioristic approach. Sometimes people, you know, just as I said, they don't want to use this one. They say it's bad, behaviorism, not good. It's for animals, asking people to react, etc. Okay, but you know, all of these have a kind of scientific background. There is something that we can use in all of these approaches and also in behavioristic approach. Okay, so we say reinforcement and punishment. We have reward and punishment in this approach. So now again, I'm going to ask your personal opinion, because you are prospective English language teachers. You will be educators. You will work as teachers. So think that you are working in a school and you have two tools. The first tool is your reward tool. The second tool is your punishment tool. Which tool is more effective? If you think that one of these tools is more effective, in what conditions? When would it be more effective? How often would you use them? In what conditions would you use these? Punishment and reinforcement. Who can say? What's your opinion? Sumaira, young learners need to get involved physically, of course, yes. You can't keep young learners sitting all the time. You need to allow them walk around the class, okay, doing some physical activities. This is something to remember. Yes, you are correct, Sumaira. Yes, so what can you say about reinforcement and punishment? How would you use these? No idea, no opinion? Merve, positive feedback, positive attitudes is better, I think. Okay, so Merve prefers to be positive, always reward, always reward, always positive towards the students. This is more motivating, maybe, she believes.
Nurdan, if we use...
Yes.
Okay, if we use the second one, children do things because of they will get punished by us, by teachers. So it's not a good thing, actually. It's not effective in learning. We should give them rewards because okay. They do things. Yeah.
Okay, so... let's read some of the other comments. Nurdan, after asking questions, if they answer correct, I would reward them, Nurdan. Hatice Fatma, reinforcement would be better when teaching vocabularies became correcting errors, and punishment would create a kind of fear to speak again. Okay, so I see that almost all of you think that punishment is bad, is not effective. In classes, in education, it means that does it mean that you will never use punishment in your classes? Be honest. Do you mean that you will never use punishment, any kind of negative thing in your classes?
Hocam, bir şey sorabilir miyim?
Yes, Hazan.
Mesela sıfır vermek de bir ceza sayılır mı? Bence sayılır.
Of course, yes.
Yani
yes.
Ödülünü yapmayan birine 100 verecek değiliz sonuçta. Yani.
Yes, her yes. Cutting points. You know, giving them low marks, this is, of course, punishment. Not in a rude way.
Hocam, ödevi yapmayan sınıfta söylemek de ceza mı?
Oh, yes. You know, saying the name, do you mean saying the names of the people who didn't do their homework?
Yes.
Yes, okay. Exposing those people to the class.
Ama hocam, ben yapmıştım ödevi.
Okay.
I send right, you an email, hocam, if you could check it.
We don't receive. Okay, we can talk about it later, but we don't receive us by email. You have to upload them to Google Classroom.
I uploaded actually.
Other people about the topic. People mostly believe in God just because of the punishment, hell, not because of the award, heaven. I want our students to do things consciously. They should be aware of everything. So here we see that actually when we regard the comment of Berkay, actually when people are scared, punishment also is effective, don't you think so? For some people, you know, okay, let's think that you reward your students by giving them stickers. Okay, stickers, you know, these nice stickers or something else like for a reward. And then you give your students sticker, then do you think that these stickers will motivate your students a lot? The first time your student receive a sticker will be fine. Then you give the second sticker, the third sticker, all right? And then after a while, what will happen? Will those stickers create the same motivation? And yeah, and what about the punishment on the other side? Punishment is necessary so as to understand they fail. Okay, okay. Sometimes people become more conscious. They understand that they have done something incorrect when they are punished.
When we give them a reward, they will get okay. They will want more actually, but it's not. It shouldn't be happen all the time. I think both punishment and reward. Mm-hmm. We will just we should do this sometimes, not all the time, mm-hmm. not always. Mm-hmm.
Okay. Anybody else? So nobody is going to use punishment. Punishment is not good. We don't like punishments. Okay. But Hasan, no, I will. I will use. Yes, you will use actually. But when will you use punishment? When will you use reward? You know, we are talking about these conscious teachers. I want you to know your philosophy. I want you to know your philosophical stance. Where do you stand? Okay, I know. I want you to know what theory you employ. At what point you are going to use exams? At what point you are going to use some kind of games? At what point, with what specific purpose you will use praise or reward or punishment? You need to be prepared for these things. So you can say, if this happens, I will use this one, and I will use it this way. All right. So in every part, in every step of our teaching. All right, our concern is vocabulary teaching, and we will come back to this point. But at every stage, we need to be very conscious. And so here, with this one, with the reinforcement and punishment, of course, we have positive and negative reinforcement. We have a positive and negative punishment. And you need to be aware of these things, because these can help you while teaching vocabulary. And these can help you not only when teaching vocabulary, but during the whole teaching process, anytime, you can become better teachers, more effective teachers. Okay, but here, when the matter is vocabulary teaching, we say that with the behavioristic approach, we have reinforcement and punishment, and in the behavioristic approach, which is more appropriate, you say, with young children, preschool children, we have some specific vocabulary teaching activity types. That are repetition. This can be written and oral repetition. Of course, those kindergarten students, they haven't learned how to write, right? But they still can speak. So you can ask them to repeat by speaking. Maybe you can teach them to write some specific some letters and then some specific words. But with the first year or second year school students, maybe you can also use the written repetition style. We have TPR. You understand what TPR is, and we already gave an example for simple matching, drawing, painting, and coloring. When you teach, for example, animals, you can give them the chance to color these, to paint these. Okay, so they learn the animal. Actually, they don't learn the word maybe, but they can see the word there written under the picture, and they will color the picture. So it's going to be a kind of simple activity that will be appropriate for preschool children. And with these preschool children, when we consider the learning theories, we believe that the behavioristic approach will be more appropriate. Right. Okay, so these are the thing, you know, positive reinforcement, negative punishment. You can be a teacher like this. You can praise them, good job, etc. Okay, now we proceed with the cognitive approach. In this approach, this is based on knowledge and knowledge retention. Okay, now we move one step forward. Now we understand that rather than using our body, we start to use our brain we use the schema in our brain, okay? And we can easily establish connections, abstract connections maybe, in our brain. So this is a kind of cognitive process. There is a lot of brain power here, okay? We use our brain and we construct something in our brain. So this is the cognitive approach, and the activities, the exercises that we can create with this approach are memorizing, guided matching, word loads, word classes, families, connections, to mention some. Okay? Hazan says Piaget. Okay. Rabia, with punishment, we need to be careful. We should reduce their stress, not increase. Yes, yes, okay. So if we go back to punishment and reward, Rabia, I agree. Punishments usually increase stress, but what about reward? Do you think that rewards really create a kind of stress-free environment? Because you know your students, they like rewards and they will want to receive reward from you, like if you are giving a sticker. So this will also create a kind of stress, different type of stress maybe. Okay, even giving rewards creates stress. Don't you think so? Yes. All right. So now we are in the cognitive step, one step ahead. So what is the most appropriate level or more appropriate level to use the cognitive approach? When can we use this approach? When can we use these vocabulary teaching exercises and activities? What do you think? Consider the proficiency level and the age of the learners. Intermediate maybe? Hazan, intermediate. Any other opinion? Pre-intermediate? Sumeyra, might be. Any other opinion? Berkay, yes, for example, if you say that you are going to give extra points in the final exam for those who attend the class most, there will be masquerade here. Yes, yes, you are right. Okay. So what about this one? The cognitive approach. Can we use the cognitive approach with preschool children? What do you think? With those children who are 3 years old, 4 years old, who haven't established those abstract links in their minds very well, who haven't learned their L1 very well, and trying to learn a different foreign language. Yes?
We cannot use, I think, because young learners learn better when the things are concrete, not abstract.
Good, yes. Concrete things, usually, most of the time. All right. So, these are the activities that you can use, which means that if you create the activities that belong to the cognitive approach and use them with children or with learners who belong to the behavioristic approach, then you will have, most probably, you will have ineffective classes. You will lose your students. They will lose their motivation, and your classes will not be that effective. What do I mean? For example, these word loads. Okay, let's go to the internet. We have internet now. This is the advantage of actually online education. Let's check some. Let's write word loads. Okay, and check the visuals, for example. Word loads, or what was the activity actually? Word classes, word maps, let's say. Maps, okay. Animals, maybe. Okay. So we have these kind of maps, word maps, or this one, let's say, this one, emotions. Okay. Open image in new tab. Okay, so have a look. If we create this kind of activity, exercise, and if we use this activity, this exercise with preschool children, can we do it? How will the activity go? Actually, right here we are talking about the emotions, and we have lots of words here. Could you just write emotions and then ask your students to write the words? Of course, they cannot write the words. They don't know writing. They haven't learned writing. How can we use this kind of thing with in the behavioristic approach with preschool children? So you understand that. You understand that as language teachers, we need to be aware of the most appropriate material for our students that will attract their attention, that will suit their needs. Two, we must be aware of the most appropriate exercise type that we can prepare with these most appropriate materials. And then three, we need to know how to conduct classes with these materials and exercises. Do you understand what I mean? So creating exercises, creating activities is easy. It is easy, but creating the most effective, the most appropriate materials, exercises, this is something that you need to think. You need to be, we said that you need to be aware of your students. You need to be aware of the knowledge, of the skills, of the interests, of the needs of your students, right? And then you need to be aware of your of their level, where they are. And you need to be aware of their age, of course. And then you will prepare the most appropriate material. Otherwise, you know, your students will lose their motivation. And usually some teachers, they complain, they say, our students, they don't listen to us. They are interested in different things. They don't do the tasks or homework or the things that we are asked them to do, etc. So partially that's because the classes are not motivating. Because sometimes the exercises that we prepare are far too simple, too easy, or sometimes they are too difficult. In both conditions, you lose the attention, you lose the motivation of your students. I hope you understand what I mean. And let's go forward. Okay, so these are some of the maps, the associations, word associations that our students can create. And what is the most appropriate level? We said that the most appropriate level would be pre-intermediate or intermediate. All right. Actually, it doesn't mean that we can't use these kind of maps in other levels like beginner or elementary or advanced, but the way that we are going to use this kind of word maps will differ. Okay. For example, another question. If you want to use this kind of word maps with our students, with our beginner level students, how can we use these? How would you use like this one, for example, house or transportation? How would you use these with beginner levels?
I would use them in a context. Firstly, I would give a context like a story, maybe a short story if it's kids. Okay, not kids actually, but then I would give the words after the context.
Okay, so Sumaira, do you mean you are going to do this with primary school children or with adult but beginner learners?
Not adults, yeah.
Adult beginner learners.
I said right, wrong, yes.
All right, it's okay. Bura, visualized versions of these word maps would work. Visualized. What do you mean, Bura? Do you mean using pictures? Instead of using words, you use pictures. Yes, okay, good idea. Right, so with the beginner level of students, you know, you can, you know, put the pictures of these things here. Transportation. You put the picture of ship, a picture of say boat, canoe, etc. And okay, you prefer this way, more visuals, more pictures. When we talk about beginner level, we always need to think that we need to consider that we will have beginner learners, then they can be adults or they can be preschool children. All right, so with preschool children, although we are doing the same thing in the same level, it could be beginner level or it could be elementary or intermediate level, we still need to consider the age of our students. And why is age important? What is your opinion? In other words, what is the difference? What would be the difference between a beginner level preschool child and a beginner level adult? What it would be the difference between these two learners? Both are beginner. Okay? What would be the difference? Development of personality or mind, good, correct. Development of personality and also mind, right? Anything else? How are these two beginner learners different? Their cognitive skills and development of brain, children tend to forget easily. All right. Development stages and characteristics, right. So you understand that the beginner level adult is actually better, should be better or have some superior skills compared to the beginner level preschool child. Because this person, the adult person, he's in full command of his L1. He writes, he can write and, you know, read. But these little children, they can't read and write, right? And they can't establish these abstract, you know, concepts in their minds. Yeah, children's mindset is different. So even when you work in this with the same level, the exercises and the activities that you are going to prepare, the vocabulary exercises or the vocabulary activities that you are going to prepare should be different. All right, and the materials also should be different. Okay, and you need also the way that you deliver these to your students should be different. So we not only consider the level, but we also consider the age. And so we can always use these kind of materials with all levels, but we need to use them in a different way. Okay, and the last step we can say is the constructivist approach. Humans construct knowledge and meaning from their experiences, as we talked. So here we have some vocabulary teaching activities like mind mapping, complex associations, complex matching, and in the following weeks, we will talk about this. What is complex mind mapping or associations or complex matching? Because we have matching, simple matching in the behavioristic approach in that step, but we also have matching here in this step. And but they are different as we speak. Now here, I want to make this bigger so you can read. Have a look. And don't be like these teachers, okay? Again, this is related to your philosophy. Some people, some teachers like to be very authoritarian and, you know, strict. And so they speak like this. I expect you all to be independent, innovative, critical thinkers, which is good. Every person, every teacher, educator speak about these things. But how many of them apply these rules, these philosophies and approaches in the class really? This is the big question. And see how the sentence goes on. Who will do exactly as I say? Well, can you understand the conflict here? You expect your students to be independent, autonomous learners. You expect them to be innovative, to try new things. You expect them to be critical thinkers, creative people, but you also want them to do exactly as you say. This won't work. This can't happen. You understand? So this is something for you. So in the constructivist approach, you can't be like that. You need to allow room for your students. Maybe, what is the level of this approach in your opinion? Constructivist approach. When do we use this approach or this theory? At what conditions, what level? When would be more appropriate to use the constructivist approach? Adult learners, yes, Sumaira, correct. Adult learners, this is, can we say, this can be high schools or university. So if you work with high school students, if you work with university students, you need to allow them to decide for the material, to decide the activities or the other things. You know, you need to leave them more room to take the responsibility of their education and so on. So prepare yourself. So when working in these kind of conditions and environments, when preparing vocabulary teaching activities, what would be more appropriate? What would you do if you were a teacher in a high school or in a university and you wanted to teach new vocabulary and you needed some vocabulary teaching activities? What would you do, for example? I wonder your opinion now. What would be your attitude? You see, you always prepare yourself for any kind of condition. If I work in a primary school, I will be like that. I will do this. If I work in secondary school, I will do this. And I will adopt this kind of material. If I work in high school, I will be that kind of teacher. If I work at university, I will be a different teacher or that kind of teacher. So prepare yourself. Be ready. Yes, what can you say? Hazan. Okay, Sumaira, one second. Okay. Class discussion might be helpful. Class discussion related to what? Vocabulary exercises or what? Yes, Sumaira.
If I in high school, I would prepare activities that catches their attention, because in high school, children like, you know, watching movies, TV series, something more, yeah, something like that. So I would prefer activities belong to these movies like Uğurhoca. University.
Thank you very much. And you believe that the movies would attract the attention of your students, and that's why you're going to use
in high school. Yes.
Okay. Okay. Any other opinion? Anybody else? All right. So here, when you prepare your vocabulary teaching activities or exercises, or maybe when you prepare the parts of vocabulary in your exam papers, okay, maybe it would be a good idea to speak to your students, to ask them, okay, how can you learn vocabulary easier? What would be the most appropriate activity for you to learn vocabulary, right? Because education, who is education for? Education is for the students. Education is not for the teachers. It shouldn't be for the authorities. Education is always about the learners and learning. It's for the students. Okay, so at that stage, at the constructive stage, we said that this would be more appropriate with the adult people, adult learners. Okay, so maybe we should ask them to prepare their own vocabulary teaching activities. Right? Because, you know, people learn better when they do things, learning by doing. So maybe you should allow, or you should ask your students to create their own vocabulary teaching exercises and activities and games. And maybe you can ask them to apply these in the classroom environment. All right? So this is something for you to think about. Right, so here we have some other elements of constructivism based on background knowledge connected new knowledge. So constructivism is the ultimate step, maybe we can say. We go step by step, maybe with behaviorism we start, and then we proceed with constructivism, and then cognitivism, excuse me, and then constructivism. And of course, there are some other discussions, like there is another step, which is social constructivism, social cognitive constructivism, etc. But we are not going to cover these things. So in this constructivism stage, knowledge of the learner is important, which will be facilitated by the teacher. But the role of the teacher will be the resource, coach, scaffolding, and modeling. This is how you can support, how you can help your students there. Because they are adults, they know their needs, they know their background, they know their knowledge. Each of them have their own experiences, okay? So for the most effective lessons, vocabulary teaching lessons, you need to consider all these things together. Now, if we summarize, we can say that the behavioristic approach is more appropriate to adopt when we deal with young children, preschool children, okay? And last week, you remember that we talked about the vocabulary lists. So I have uploaded these lists here for you in your course materials in UK. Okay, when you go to course materials, you will see these vocabulary lists. But before I talk about these lists, again, I want to ask you something. After the lesson last week, did you go and search the net? Did you download any vocabulary lists? Could you find something? Is there anybody who downloaded the list? I did. Burak, what did you do? Azan, yes, but not in English. In what language, Azan? What kind of lists did you find? In Arabic, I looked. Okay. I didn't download, but I looked for German vocabulary. Okay. Okay, so you see, and I try to know my level. Okay. I looked at English corpora. All right. So you see that there are vocabulary lists almost in every language. So if you want to learn a language on our own, we can go and download these lists, vocabulary lists, and then start learning these vocabulary, these words. Okay. So here I uploaded these lists, the first 1,000 words in English, the most frequently used 1,000 words. The second most common words in English, second 1,000. So these are in total 2,000, the first 2,000 words, right? And here, the five most commonly used words in English, the academic word list, top 2,000 English vocabulary words used in speaking. Okay, so you can check and download all these here and use them in the future, of course. But here, while summarizing, we said we agree that the behavioristic approach is more appropriate with young children, young learners, preschool children. So we can say that A1 level, they will be A1 learners and beginner level most of the time. So 500 most frequent word lists will be appropriate for these learners. Okay. And when we consider the cognitivist approach and vocabulary instruction, we can say that these will be A2 level, B1 and B2 mostly. So intermediate level and the most frequent 2,000 word list will be appropriate for them. And for the constructivist approach, C1 level, C2 level, advanced level learners, the most frequent 5,000 words in English and the academic word list is important. How many words do you know? What is your level? If I ask you, what is your level? By the way, we are talking about this A1, A2, B1, B2, C1, C2 levels. What is it?
B1, you know, maybe.
Yeah, B1 maybe, okay.
C1.
C1. Does everyone know what these levels mean? This is how we grade people. This is how we, yes, common European framework for languages. Okay, so you understand. You understand that we can teach or we can use these vocabulary lists while adopting the vocabulary teaching stance in our classes. When we teach learning by or starting from vocabulary. All right. And the task of your week is here. If you go to our Google Classroom, check the classwork part. Task 2, week 2, task 2, click, reveal it. What is the task? Prepare a vocabulary activity sheet. This is going to be 10 points. And these are your instructions. Use the 500 most commonly used words list. Create, design at least two activities. Consider the proficiency level and also the age of your students. This is the list here. I have downloaded it. It is in UK, as I said. So see, read that part. Here are the 500 most commonly used words in English language. Learn these or teach these and you will know more than 2/3 of all vocabulary in written English. Isn't it nice? Great. And these are the words. Two is the most frequent word in English. You have the words here. These are the words that you can use. You don't have to use, of course, all of these, but the activities that you are going to prepare should be formed of these words. So pick the words that you like to use from among these in the list. This is 4 pages, and prepare 2 activities. This is going to be the task of this week. What is the due date? October 20. All right. Do you have any questions? Is everything clear?
Hocam hangi levele uygun yapacağız?
The level. So if you are going to use the first, the most common 500 words, what does it mean? It means that the level is beginner. Hazan. So the activities that you are going to prepare should be beginner level. Beginner level. Can I use different levels for each activity?
Well, sordum. Pardon, level değil ya.
The level. Okay. Oh, you mean the age. Right. So maybe if you want, the level should be beginner level because you are using only the most frequent 500 words, which belong to the beginner level, I think. Okay. And then if you want, you can prepare 1 activity for preschool children and 1 activity for adult beginner learners. Okay, or if, it's up to you. If you want, you can prepare 2 activities, both prepared for preschool children or young children, or 2 activities that will be prepared for adult, beginner level adults. All right. Okay. Any other opinion? Any other question or something that you would like to ask to make this more clear? I will be very happy to review your exercises, and sometimes, as I said, we create wonderful exercises that do not work in real life because they are way too difficult, or you know, very very simple that will, you know, not motivate or attract our students. So consider all the things that we talked today while preparing your exercises. The task will be 1 or 2 pages, not longer than that. If you want to allocate 1 page for each activity, then it will take 2 pages, but you can divide the page into 2 and put 1 activity on the top and the other activity on the bottom. Will you upload this PowerPoint? Okay, so you mean these slides of this week, Sumaira? You want me to upload them? All right. While uploading, this is week 1 PowerPoint slides. I will make another one.
Hocam, bu arada bir şey sorabilir miyim?
Week 2, yes, PowerPoint slides. And
bugünkü şey neydi? Bir tane paragraf yazmamız istendi ya, hani ödevimiz vardı ya hocam.
Yes.
O saat 12'ye kadarmış herhalde. Ben onu yüklemekte biraz güçlük çektim. Drive'ı kullanmadığım için normalde. Hani biraz geç yükledim. Yukarıda şey yazıyor. Geç teslim edildi diyor. Sorun olur mu?
No, it's all right. As long as you upload it before the lesson, it's all right.
Dersten önce yüklemiştim.
I'll see, I'll check it. I'll check it all. So here is the PowerPoint slides uploaded and all the other materials that you need to complete the task. Any other questions? Do you have any other questions? Is the task clear? What kind of exercises can we do? Well, Sinan, the exercises, the activities that you are going to prepare should be appropriate to your audience, to your students. So if you are going to prepare both activities for preschool children, it means that you need to prepare activities that will be of that kind. Repetition, TPR, simple matching, drawing, painting, coloring, etc. But if you are going to prepare one of the activities for adult beginner level students, then you can rearrange the activity. So consider all the things that we spoke today. You get it. Anything else? Any other questions? How can I reach the list of websites you showed us last year? The list of websites. Do you mean last year or last week? Do you mean the websites where you can find the vocabulary list, or what do you mean, Esra? WordPress.
Hocam herhalde sizin öğretim teknolojilerindeki şeylerinizi söylüyorum.
You did homework. And you are asking for the list of websites. Well, if you can write me an email and explain this, I will try to help. Okay? Send me an email. Because it's hard for me right now to recall what websites you are asking for. Okay. Yes. Any other questions related to the task? Related, or is there anything that you disagree? We talked many things here. Okay. Maybe there is something that you disagree, or maybe there is something that you would like to add or share, if there is something like that.
Hocam, nasıl size bu aktiviteyi açıklayacağız? Rapor şeklinde mi?
No, you won't explain. You will prepare the activity and you will upload the document. And next week we will view your exercises, we will open the documents here, and then we will talk on them. I will give you feedback, and your students, your classmates will give you feedback. So you will explain your activity then. Only put your activities on the paper now.
Hocam, PowerPoint'tan sunumayla yapsak olur mu?
No, you don't need PowerPoint. You need Word, okay? Word or PDF. All right?
Hocam, anladım. Bir aktivite hazırlayacağız. Burada atacaksınız siz ve arkadaşlar da yapmaya çalışacak ya da onun üstüne
konuşacağız. We will just explain the activity here. We will talk about the activity that you prepare. And that's it. You will receive your feedback. That's it. You don't have to apply the activity. Just prepare it. Prepare an activity that you can use in classrooms with your students. Is it clear?
Tamam hocam. Evet. Ben rapor hazırlayacağız sandım.
No,
hani
not
şöyle
report.
Yapıyoruz. Şöyle.
No. I want the activity, the exercise. The exercise itself. Okay, anything else? Anything else? Okay, so I assume that everything is clear. I assume that you understand what you are supposed to do. Follow the due dates, follow the deadlines, okay? And I will see you next week. As always, stay safe and healthy. Beware COVID-19 and wear 2 double masks when you go out, okay? Because this is serious. So take care and see you next week. Bye.